proceeding of the manufacturing production of the antibody and launching currently ongoing human clinical trials to study it. In recent years, John has also led efforts to map the code evidence and isolated such antibodies in the setting. John is not only a visionary and highly productive scientist, but also a wise and generous person for whom countless researchers seek guidance, including myself. Please join me in welcoming John Pasola. Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you, Dr. Fauci, for the kind introduction. I'm honored to be asked to give this lecture this year, and actually quite excited about a topic which I discussed with Tony. And the idea of the talk today will be to give you all some sense of why, for some vaccines, for some diseases, where if you don't get a vaccine, they need to apply these tools that we call structure-based vaccine design, B-cell autoimmune. And so, the way I'll structure the talk is to first give you some background on vaccines in general, the successes, but also remaining challenges with vaccines. And then I'm going to explain these terms because I appreciate that B-cell autoimmune is not an inherently obvious term to everybody. And to give you examples of how we use these tools, I chose three viruses, so the talk will focus mainly on viruses, but the viruses will be RSV, HIV, and influenza. So first, let's talk a little bit about the public health impact of vaccines. And these are data from the Center for Disease Control that are compiled every few years. The red bar shows the number of cases in a year of any given disease in the pre-vaccine era, and the blue bar shows the year 2012. And you recognize diseases, measles, mumps, hepatitis A. And those are, there were hundreds of thousands of cases per year in the pre-vaccine era, and then there are now hundreds or no cases at all. And once you actually look at the actual numbers, which I think is helpful, I kind of like, or I use the example of measles, mumps, rubella, because I think everybody knows that the children get that at age 15 months, and students get boosted before they go to college. And you see that in the 1950s, hundreds of thousands of cases going down, which actually be a handful of cases. Congenital Bell syndrome no longer happens in the United States, nor does scarlet polio, all because of the success of vaccines. So how do we get there? We use what we now call classic vaccine approaches. We can grow up a virus, and I'm using viruses as an example, but bacterial vaccines often use similar conceptual vaccine technologies. We can live attenuate the virus, we can kill it chemically. And then in more recent years, so in 1986, we had our first protein, we call it protein subunit vaccine, which was hepatitis B. And in the 2000s, we had our first virus-like particle vaccine, which is an empty particle with nucleic acid, and that was based on pioneering work of the Lowy and John Schiller here at CIA. So now we call all these pretty classic approaches, and all of them stimulate the body's immune system to generate both antibodies, and I'll focus more on the antibody response here, but also importantly, helper T cells and killer T cells. Good vaccines give us lifelong protective immunity at a pretty high level. Importantly, though, there are many human diseases for which we don't have a vaccine. So I list some of them, not all of them here, but we often talk about the big three being malaria, tuberculosis, and HIV, because these diseases cause such a huge global epidemic. Respiratory syncytial virus, cytomegaly virus, Epstein-Barr virus, hepatitis C, chikungunya, all diseases for which we don't have a vaccine. Many parasitic diseases that I won't talk about. Also, we're in great need of effective vaccines. If we look again at CDC data for just the United States, you can see the number of cases for these, and oftentimes people don't think about hepatitis C or norovirus. Millions of cases for some of these, even if it's gastroenteritis or respiratory infection, with sometimes thousands of deaths. Even influenza, for which we have what you really can say is just a modestly effective vaccine, tens of thousands of cases a year. I particularly like a little spot on the CNN website that someone brought to my attention, because it was during the 2014 Ebola outbreak, where I think everybody remembers that we had very concerning imported cases substituted here at the clinical center. But this little spot brought up, I think, a reasonable point that if you think about the scariest viruses, even in the United States, may not be able to follow these, but there are many, many cases. It was a nice educational piece I thought. But let's look outside the United States. So according to data that are compiled annually by the World Health Organization, infectious diseases are the second leading cause of death in the world, second only to heart disease and stroke. When we go back to these major diseases, the ECV, HIV, malaria, respiratory diseases in general, diarrheal diseases in general, cause in on the order of millions of deaths globally a year, disproportionately affecting children oftentimes, and in all these cases, vaccine development could have a major impact. And then lastly, we keep learning about new diseases. We think of Ebola as an old disease, but that was really recognized only in 1976. HIV only recognized in 1981. SARS, chikungunya, MERS, and you can be assured that there'll be a disease here down the line in another few years. So the need for vaccines persists. And so we have many successes, but we have obvious severe viruses and other pathogens, but we don't have a vaccine. The question is why, and what can we do about it? So I'm going to explain what I mean by structure-based vaccine design and B-cell autoimmune and give you some examples. So by way of definitions, there are no dictionary definitions for these because they're pretty new concepts, so I made these up and I take full responsibility for any imprecision in them, but for structure-based vaccine design, what we generally mean, and I'll use a virus as an example just to make it more tangible, we use atomic level structural information to manipulate or change viral protein to improve its antigenic profile and make it a better vaccine. And then B-cell autogeny was really coined based on the classical definition of autogeny that we know in biology, which is the developmental history of an organism from a fertilized egg to a mature organism. So we borrow that concept and say that starting from a single B-cell, which produces antibodies, we study the evolution of the antibody response, if you call it antibody family or antibody clonal family, as it evolves in the process of putting maturation. So those are the definitions. They make it a little bit easier to look at it visually, and many people know HIV here in the room. So we know that HIV has a surface envelope like a protein, the envelope. We actually talk about this in a minute. We have the structure of that envelope. We have the antibody that binds that envelope. So you can think of a structure-based vaccine design as saying, given a known antibody that we think is a good antibody, and given its known viral epitope here, can we design a vaccine to restrict that antibody? If we know the structure, we should be able to do that structure-based vaccine design. B-cell autogeny asks, how did the immune system generate this antibody? What was the evolution of the B-cell response? And the point I'll make is that for some diseases, HIV, RSV, we need to know this kind of information, or what we'd like to know is they can take a vaccine. So one of the points about structure-based vaccine design and B-cell autogeny is that they're fairly new concepts. They've been around for a little bit more than 5 years, but really the field is focused on them. So these are pretty new concepts. It's the work of several groups, and I'll highlight those who contributed, but Duke University and Scripps Research Institute are major groups that are studying these types of things along with the vaccines research center in the state of NIAID. I think that these concepts have been strongly influenced by HIV, but certainly now influenza and RSV, the fields have begun to use these concepts. And all of this is still early in the proof of principle stage. So the first vaccines based on structure-based vaccine design are just moving to the clinic. So I'll start with a couple of examples. So RSV to start with, which is probably the most straightforward example we have of structure-based vaccine design. An important point for viral immunology is that despite the fact that the immune system is complex, we need helper T cells, CD8 T cells to control infection, a critical component of all successful viral vaccines and most vaccines in general is that we need strong antibody responses called the neutralizing antibodies. We have a very good vaccine for hepatitis B and antibodies, hepatitis B surface antigens are critical. Our flu vaccines produce antibodies to influenza, it could be better antibodies, and for HIV we seek to reduce antibodies to neutralize HIV. So I'll focus to a large extent on antibodies to the viral surface protein, which you can see here. And I'll start with respiratory syncytial virus. So this virus causes severe pneumonia, particularly in very young children and older adults. Each year, tens of thousands of hospitalizations and thousands of deaths are caused by RSV. Worldwide, this virus kills more children, young children, than any other pathogen except malaria, which is a major killer of children. And we've been working on vaccines since the 1960s without success. So we know a lot about viruses, we think we're pretty good with vaccines, but we haven't been able to make a vaccine for RSV. The question is, why is that? It can be reduced by Barney Graham and others on the topic. So the vaccine was finally 1960s, a fascinating story. It made perfectly good sense. We had successes with polio and other viruses. It made a formula that activated vaccine, coronavirus in the lab, 7.7, and that was done. It was made as a vaccine, it was kept in the early 1960s. The vaccine turned out to be a pretty big antibody response. We'll talk about that in a minute. Importantly, the vaccine failed to work. It did not protect children. There was even cases of enhanced pneumonia in children. That's a pretty complicated story that I won't talk about in detail. But importantly, clearly the vaccine didn't work. So despite more than 50 years of research, we don't have a vaccine for RSV. So I borrowed some slides from really the campus experts on RSV and early respiratory viruses, your college, LID, right, the DRC, to show you that viruses have surface proteins, and a key surface protein in RSV is called fusion protein, or this, what we call the F protein. And so I'm going to talk about this F protein a little bit. And so we can look at surface proteins in many viruses. So what's fascinating is that all these surface proteins actually are related. They're all trivalent proteins. They're all what we call type 1 fusion proteins, so they mediate fusion. And even though the viruses, parainfluenza virus, influenza, HIV, Ebola, are quite different, there are certain structural similarities in all these surface proteins, and they all mediate violence between them. So how does that happen? Here's the viral fusion protein. It could be any virus, unless it's a respiratory virus. The fusion protein has to contact the cellular receptor. And of course, the virus wants to get into the cell. So first, the protein engages the receptor. Then the protein changes its conformation, and it starts to fuse peptide into the cell surface, and it pulls the virus and the host cell together and injects the viral cell fusion. So structural biologists call fusion proteins entry machines, because they actually have a thermodynamic entry mechanism where they change conformation and hold the virus and the host cell together. And you can see that here again. And the critical components of entry machine fusion proteins are that they can be metastable. So fusion proteins are designed to alter conformation, unless they're often inherently unstable, and that's often called metastable. So you see the fusion protein here, and you can see after it's changed conformation and pulled the host cell and the virus together, you have the post-fusion conformation. That becomes very important for respiratory system virus. So respiratory system virus investigators for years have known that if you look at a cholesterol like graph of RSV binding from a cell, and you look very closely, you can see two forms of the fusion protein. One form turns out to be pre-fusion, and the other post-fusion. And so investigators have color-coded that here, pre-fusion in red, and post-fusion in blue. And you ask, well, why does the virus have a bunch of post-fusion on its cell surface? That's not what it needs to the cell, it's the pre-fusion after form. And part of the reason is that it's a metastable protein. And depending on the virus, some of the protein triggers into the post-fusion conformation. So you can see that depicted here, where over time, with the temperature or getting the virus in place 37 degrees or in low salt preparation, many of the pre-fusion proteins will become and trigger the post-fusion. This is worked on by Brian Graham of the DRC. And so in retrospect, one of the key explanations related to the vaccine that didn't work is that the 3F protein, the pre-fusion protein, flips to the post-fusion during the process of activation. So 37 degrees centigrade at a low dose of formaldehyde to activate the virus. So it's very likely that the vaccine, the vaccine coverage looks like this, most of the protein on the surface in the post-fusion form. So again, the vaccine was tested in the 50s and it was a weak response and it didn't work. So what do we understand about that now? So what we think, and the hypothesis from all of that work, was that the vaccine that we would like to have given should have been a vaccine that had mostly pre-fusion F on it. And that can be done by using a live attenuated vaccine, which is still an active research area, or by using more common recombinant protein technologies now, which are hepatitis B and others have been around for years. We can simply express the recombinant 3F protein. The problem is it's unstable, and what investigators realize is what we need to do is stabilize this protein. So this is a structure-based vaccine. We need to stabilize pre-fusion F RSV protein. So how does that work? So first of all, one needs structural information, and the post-fusion form of the protein was solved as a crystal structure in 2011, and the pre-fusion was solved in 2013, so this is pretty recent work. Oftentimes, in structural biology, you need an antibody to be linked to a bound to a protein sacred crystals. That's what was done here. This is just an example of a crystal computer quantum group, and this is a publication by Graham and Long Laboratories, in this case by Jason McClellan, where it was the structure of RSV F by protein trimer bound to a pre-fusion specific antibody. So we have now the structure of pre-fusion F. And so what can you do with that? We simply want to make a vaccine. We have all the structural information. So the goal is to maintain this and prevent this. And if you know enough about the chemistry, that's possible. So the structural biologists often do it have a crystal structure. So remember, this is a trimeric protein, which means it has three identical subunits, which are called tautomers. If they use what's called a ribbon diagram or a ribbon representation, it's a core of the subunits of this picture here. And you can see what the pre-fusion structure looks like in detail. This is the protein here in the cell membrane, the myelin. This is the protein top. And when the pre-fusion protein triggers the post-fusion, the fusion peptide goes from here to way up here and sticks into the cell. So you need this conformational change in order for the virus protein to work. So what we seek to do is to maintain the structure and not allow this. And what investigators did, if they looked at this, and I'll keep it simplified, but non-structural biologists view, is if you take these two amino acids, you can see what they look like here, they're close together. In the post-fusion. So see, these two amino acids are very separate. They're very different states. So instead of keeping these adhering, they were changed to cysteine bonds, and they made an engineered cysteine bond to hold this structure in place. So basically, it doesn't allow this to change, it doesn't allow this to happen. So that's structure-based vaccine designed for RSV. There were other mutations that were used. Cavity-filling mutations are hydrophobic amino acids that help keep the structure in place. So sometimes we put a domain on the protein to hold it together. So there were several mutations in total. We didn't just want to do this in the structural space, we wanted to make a protein. So these mutations in total allowed us to express a stabilized pre-fusion protein and keep it stable. So now we have something we can use to test the vaccine. And when that was done, the important data are that this protein is more immunogenic. So several groups have tried RSV vaccines in the older sets, and the vaccine and the protein was post-fusion. So the immunogenicity of post-fusion vaccines is not very good. What was hoped and what clearly was shown in monkeys here in immunogenicity was that a pre-fusion protein is a much better immunogen. So in fact, this type of work is now progressing. This work is just 2013. This type of product and technology has been licensed. And according to the vaccine center, we're going to do a phase 1 study in early 2017. The concept of the phase 1 study will be to prove the concept that in humans, this type of protein can affect boost immune response. Most people, so in elderly population, they'll be pre-immune. You have to reduce or boost their immune response. And in infants, presumably this would be a better vaccine to try to go with a pre-F vaccine. So this is one of the first and clearest examples of using structural biology to make or change a protein and change its antigenic profile and its immunogenic profile. I'll give you an example for HIV, where we need to use actually both concepts, both structure-based vaccine design and B-cell enhancement. So why is that? It's not because HIV is a more complicated pathogen from the immune standpoint. So for RSV, we basically had an unstable trimer, and that could be fixed, as I showed you. But if you look at the protein surface is exposed, there are just a few glycans or sugars on it. The opposite sort of part of the spectrum is HIV, which is also an unstable trimer, so we need to stabilize it. It's completely covered in sugars or glycans, and it's very diverse. So the purple part, more purple, and maybe all those glycans, and it's diverse. So with RSV, it's pretty simple. We use this to see it, see if it's stabilized. Here we have a much more complex situation. Why is that? So as for vaccines, well, the glycosylation limits the available protein surface. The antibody needs at some point to contact the protein surface. And the glycans essentially get in the way. And the diversity means that an antibody that works against one strain may or may not work against another strain. So antibodies, that what we need for HIV are antibodies that are able to penetrate the glycan shield and target conserved episodes. And this has been a major obstacle to HIV vaccine funding. It's not easy in the HIV vaccine space to get the right kind of antibodies. So you should have an interest by looking at natural history. Point is that special often nations learn from the natural history of infection. For HIV, when you get viremia, can very quickly begin antibodies for the virus, and that's how we diagnose the infection. But they're binding antibodies. It takes months to get neutralizing antibodies. If this were RSV, or most acute viruses, polio, hepatitis A, these antibodies would come up in weeks. When HIV can come in, would come up in months, gives us your first clue that this type of pathogen is different. The type of antibodies we really want, which are more cross-reactive, can take years to come up. So we have to, for HIV, an immunological problem, in addition to a structural problem. This translates into the real world of vaccinology because we have tried several types of vaccine candidates for HIV as vaccines and they have failed to work. So CT120 is a simple recombinant protein, so if this is the primer, the CT120 is one of the subunits. We have used gene-based vaccines where we put genes of HIV into a genetic vector like an adenovirus, or combined DNA and adenovirus, or we combine pox virus vectors with proteins. These vaccines failed to work, so essentially they do not protect in placebo-controlled trials at all. And this vaccine protected at 31% efficacy, which is not good enough yet. We need to build on that. So importantly, we get poor neutralizing antibody responses in all these vaccines. And by that we mean low potency and limited breadth, limited cost reactivity. So we have a sense from the antibody perspective why that happens. Again, we immunize with CT120, and the antibodies elicited by CT120 immunization do not affect the binding trimer. So we get lots of antibodies to CT120, but the surface of 120 is buried on the trimer. So if this were RSV, it would be a problem. What we want, our antibodies can actually bind to the trimer, and we neutralize the virus. So the question is, how do we get there? How do we take that immunological step? So first generation vaccine protein from one RSV-120, it is high binding before neutralizing antibodies. Natural infection does induce strain-specific neutralizing antibodies, especially everybody over time. But the broadly neutralizing antibodies that we want with the vaccine, which cross rapid brain strain, are found in the sera only about 20% of HIV infected people. We don't understand exactly why that is, but part of this chronic nature in HIV and the fact that it invades the immune system. So some years ago, we were working with Mark Carnes here at NIAID and studied subjects that were part of the clinical trials. So here these are 80 individuals on the X-axis who are HIV infected and each got the virus. And what you can see is that some donors make weak neutralizing antibody responses, and some most viruses they don't neutralize. And some donors neutralize most viruses high titers. So this was the first clue, and it's pretty obvious here, that we're interested in these donors. These donors make really poor antibody responses, kind of even with vaccine. So what can we do? We can isolate the antibodies from these individuals. I'll show you how to do that. We can study how they neutralize structurally, and we can ask how the immune system makes them. So we can do the structural biology and the cell biology on these cells. The technology to call antibodies has advanced in the last few years. So we can take a protein probe, an HIV probe, mix it with B cells, or we can do cell sorting, and these are HIV-specific B cells. We can take an individual B cell and TCR amplify the heavy light chain. Antibody genes, that technology has been routine in the last 5 years. So from a B cell, we can express in the laboratory the antibody made by that B cell receptor. So if we do that, and I'll jump ahead some years now, since 2009 to about 2016, the field has isolated literally hundreds of potent neutralizing antibodies against HIV. And these antibodies define the epitopes of the virus. So each of these blue patches is where an antibody binds. Binds here, it's called T3 glycan. So the antibody gets through the glycan, actually interacts with the glycan, touches this patch, or touches the green.